You've broken down a whole beast. You're left with trimmings. You know, in my industry, we call those trimmings. Get rid of all of the bits that no one wants. The bits of sinew, the bits of meat, the bits that can't be turned into a cut.
You're a vegetarian, aren't you, love? Yeah, sorry.
You know, the butcher. Dan, you paid to get this taken away, yeah?
Yes.
In this form, this is inedible. Why? Because it's the outside of the meat, from the cavity where the guts are. It's full of anything from salmonella, E. coli, and different stuff like that. Tell these people where the trim goes.
It goes to a rendering plant where they make chicken food, dog food.
Okay, this is not fit for human consumption. Why is it good for dog food? Because dogs have got more efficient stomachs. They can handle this stuff. But what would you think if I told you, in America, they've come up with a piece of technology that can turn this into something that ends up in your school food? Pink slime is allowed in any school in America by the USDA. So, first things first, this is how I imagine the process to be. Over here, I have something that you probably know well. They don't really put it in a washing machine, but they take all those trimmings, all the stuff that Dan pays to get taken away, they put it into a centrifuge, and they spin it. Now what does that do? It splits the fat from the meat and separates it. So then you end up with stuff like this. I want you to have a look at this. It's important that you kind of see this stuff. Then you end up with all the very, very last bits of meat. So what they do is fascinating. And to me as a chef and a food lover is shocking. You've probably got one of these cupboards, probably under the sink, with a char block. And in there is going to be all your household chemicals, stuff that you don't want your kids getting their hands on. The key ingredient to the process is ammonia. We're going to wash these lean bits of beef that we've spun around there in a water and ammonia solution. I don't know how much, and the water, there's a specific ratio, but basically they wash this meat and that kills the E. coli and salmonella and any kind of pathogens. So then we drain it. We drain it and then we mince it. So basically, we're taking a product that would be sold at the cheapest form for dogs, and after this process, we can give it to humans.
We as a nation have to start thinking about consuming, growing, and feeding our children food that's not chocked full of chemicals. We can't keep feeding our kids pesticides and herbicides and antibiotics and hormones. We can't keep doing that. You know, it doesn't work. And the results of that are kids getting sick. One of my big soapboxes right now is antibiotics. 70% of all antibiotics consumed in America is consumed in animal husbandry. We are feeding our kids antibiotics in beef and other animal protein every day. 70%. It's unbelievable. And the result of it is we have diseases, we have things like E. coli that we can't fix, that we can't make kids better when they get sick. And, you know, certainly antibiotics have been prescribed, but it's an issue in the food supply. One of my favorite facts is that U.S. agriculture uses 1.2 billion pounds of pesticides every year. That means every one of us and our children consumes what would equal a 5-pound bag, those bags you have at home, if I had one here, and ripped it open, and that pile I would have on the floor is what we consume and feed our children every year because of what goes into our food supply, because of the way we consume produce in America. The CDC has said that of the children born in the year 2000, that one out of every three Caucasians and one out of every two African Americans and Hispanics will have diabetes in their lifetime. And if that's not awful enough, most before they graduate high school. If we're looking at 40 or 45% of our children within 10 years are going to be diabetic. Diabetes used to be an old people's disease. I mean, my grandparents had it. What are we going to do when these 18-year-old kids have had diabetes for 4 or 5 years? How long will they live? What's their life expectancy going to be? What's their quality of life going to be? You know, it's going to be like that movie WALL-E, where everybody's in these wheelchairs, too fat to move around. I mean, you know, we have to change this. There's nothing more important. But whoever decided that a chicken should look like a heart, a giraffe, a star? Well, Tyson did, because there's no chicken in the chicken.
I wanted to see if the kids even knew what fresh food looks like.
Are you ready for my class?
We are ready. Welcome.
Thank you very much for letting me. How old are you guys?
Six.
Six? Wow.
I love working with kids. Elementary school is where it's at. You know, this is where you mold kids.
We're going to do a little test.
Right. The test I did with the kids today was shocking.
Do you know what that is? Do you know what that is?
Broccoli.
What about this? A good old friend. Do you know what this is, honey?
Celery.
No. What do you think it is, darling?
Onion.
Onion, no.
Immediately, you get a really clear sense of do the kids know anything about where food comes from.
Who knows what that is?
A pear.
A pear, no.
A turnip.
No. Okay, I'm going to give you the first word. Egg.
Egg.
Egg salad.
The answer today was no.
There are 17 million American children that could literally go hungry every day that they're not in school, because the only access they get to food at all is school food.
I eat for school lunch is chips, a hamburger. The pizza is really good, but it's actually not healthy for you.
When I go down there and we're serving it, I know that I don't want to eat it and that I don't think it's healthy, but yet I'm serving it to 600 kids.
We have a real crisis in our country. I know a lot of people call it the obesity crisis. 50% of children between the ages of 2 and 15 have fatty streaks in their arteries, and this is literally the beginning stages of heart disease.
Nobody is safe from the dangers of the child obesity epidemic.
If they're eating junk food in schools, then the schools are telling them that that's okay, it's appropriate, it's what happens in schools. That's not right.
And when you see what's in the cafeterias now, you can't blame the lunch workers. They don't have anything but an Alto-Shan to, like, you know, heat food up to a safe temperature, and it's barely food at that.
The government who's making the choices. They're the ones who are vetting these providers. They're the ones who are making decisions about what the kids eat. And the parents really don't know. They have no idea what's on the menu or where it is coming from and whether the companies that are providing it have really poor track records.
And the reason this is happening, by and large, is because of our food system and the way the government commodifies food, the way the government oversees our food, the way the USDA puts food on kids' plates that's unhealthy and allows unhealthy food into schools. And by tacitly, all of us send our kids or grandchildren or nieces or nephews to school and tell them to learn, you know, learn what's in those schools. And when you feed these kids bad food, that's what they're learning. So that's really what this is all about. The way we got here is because of big agribusiness. We now live in a country where most of us don't decide, by and large, what we eat. We see big businesses, Monsanto and DuPont, who brought out Agent Orange and stain-resistant carpet. They control 90% of the commercially produced seeds in our country. These are 10 companies control much of what's in our grocery stores, much of what people eat, and that's really, really a problem.
What happens is that farmers in the industrial system grow too much of various things. The government buys it from them to support their prices and their welfare, and then dumps it on schools. It's about money. I mean, we spend pennies on each school lunch, and to treat our children that way, we supposedly care very much about their health and development, but we feed them junk. It's just shameful. And also because of budgetary problems, the school cafeterias, they no longer have kitchens. They have giant microwaves. So they're utterly dependent on processed food. They couldn't cook it if they wanted to. The rules make it very hard to change it. It's very hard for a school lunch program to buy locally, to buy Whole Foods. There are rules that say they have to take the lowest bidder, which is often not the local farmer. And also, even if you do want to buy local, say you wanted to serve hamburgers made from grass-fed beef. Well, if the government is giving you crummy industrial beef, it's very hard to justify that economically. So, this program has got to be changed both at the local level, with parents and children insisting that they want better food in their schools, but also there's going to have to be changes at the federal level.
It all comes from tax dollars. USDA spends $8 billion of our tax money a year. It comes down to $2.57 or $2.59, depending on where you are, for reimbursable meals. In most school districts, two-thirds goes to payroll and overhead. So you're left with 80 cents or maybe even a dollar for food. I mean, think about that dollar. I don't know about you, but you know, I go to Starbucks or Pete's or whatever, and you get a venti latte in San Francisco, it's $5. We now live in a country where we spend more money on our daily coffee than we're spending to feed our children for an entire week. It's unconscionable. The government also sets the guidelines that say this is a healthy meal. Chicken nuggets, tater tots, chocolate milk, and canned fruit cocktail with high fructose corn syrup is allowable. The government will pay me to feed that to children every day. So now you have school food people and principals and parents going, oh, we're serving healthy food. The government says so. Besides the $2.59 and from the feds and the 19 cents from the state, all schools get 19 cents per kid for free lunches. You don't actually get the 19 or 19 and a half cents. You get it in what's called commodity food. So for instance, maybe the government buys a load of chicken from Tyson. Now, what we do is just get what's called brown box. We get the whole cases of chicken, but very, very, very few schools do that. Most schools will opt to come together as co-ops and have those chickens made into chicken nuggets. So now the chicken has never left Tyson, and Tyson has been paid for the chicken. Then Tyson actually builds that chicken into chicken nuggets, sends it to the school district, and charges the school district a processing and delivery fee. So the USDA really doesn't make this a priority. What they're really making a priority is the crap that these big agribusiness companies are producing and feeding to us and our children. So we ought to blow up the USDA.
I wish that there was more of a variety to the lunch, but other than that,
talk louder.
It's okay. I'm eating a sandwich right now, so.
You think there could be improvements?
Yeah.
Such as what?
More variety and like make it look better. Like it.
So Steph, what do you think about school lunch?
Horrible.
What's wrong with it?
All the food is like dry, the cheese is dry, the bread, like when you get the cheeseburger sandwiches, the bread is like stale and like hard and gross, and like the meat is like rubbery, it's not even good.
The meat from the sandwiches?
Yeah, it's not even good. And the pizza's only just like real pizza, like what is that?
What do you think about the vegetables and the fruits that they offer?
The vegetables are, they're really soft, like the broccoli is like, it's just gross.
Tell me about an experience you had with school lunch.
Well, a couple weeks ago, I was drinking the ordinary school milk from the lunch line, and something wasn't tasting right then. I was drinking, I was like, wow, something's just off about this. And so I looked at the sell-by date on the top of the milk, and it was like a week and a half expired. So it just wasn't right. So I brought it up to the lunch lady, and she said, it doesn't matter. You can grab another one, but you'll be fine. Which, drinking expired milk isn't fine.
So when I started thinking about these issues and how I was going to change what kids ate, I really started focusing on what we would teach them. And the very first thing was about regional food, trying to eat food from within our region. And clearly, with what's going on with fossil fuel usage, or when as the fossil fuel is going away, as oil hits its peak oil, you know, we really have to start thinking about whether or not we should or could be moving food 1,500 miles before we eat it. So we talk to kids about that, and we really start to feed kids regional food. And then we talk about organic food. Now, most school districts can't really afford organic food, but anyone in any part of the country can serve fresh fruits and vegetables. You just have to think seasonally. I mean, you do a lot of root vegetables, you do a lot of cooking greens, and you also put stuff by. So when I say fresh, I mean that it came in fresh. We actually built a freezer and bought 8,000 pounds, 4 tons of product over the course of the summer that we froze and processed to serve in the winter. It's not about being in California at all. And even in California, we have seasons. I mean, I only serve tomatoes
till the end of October and there's no more tomatoes. I think school lunch should be a health initiative. I think it should be taken away from the USDA and put under the CDC, Center for Disease Control, or Health and Human Services. We raise the guidelines so a healthy meal isn't chicken nuggets, you know, tater tots, canned fruit cocktail, and chocolate milk. The next thing I would do is say that all meals would be universal. Universal breakfast, universal lunch. That every child in America deserves a birthright. Birthright in our country should be that they get fed a healthy breakfast and a healthy lunch at school. And then I'd get rid of all competitive foods. Now, in most school districts, they sell everything from slushies to donuts to cookies. We don't sell stuff here. We're not all organic. We're not all local. I still use commodity chicken, even though I think it supports, you know, really bad, you know, unsustainable food supplies. So I guess those are the kind of compromises. But we need to get rid of the processed foods. We need to ban trans fats, ban high fructose corn syrup, ban food colors and additives and, you know, hormones and antibiotics and animal husbandry. We need to be feeding kids healthy food. End of story. Every day, myself, my executive chef, and my sous chef get in at 5, and we start cooking for the day. So we cook 250 pounds of pasta, 350 pounds of broccoli. We're mixing the cheese sauce, which we make from scratch and doesn't come out of a can, with the pasta, and that's getting packed out to schools. Broccoli's getting packed out to schools. Once a month, we have hamburgers. They're grass-finished Hearst Ranch hamburgers. And then the next month, we'll have hot dogs, both from Hearst Ranch. Most schools might serve hamburgers or hot dogs all the time, but because we're buying this high-quality product, we can't afford it, so we serve it less often. It takes, you know, 10 or 12 hours to cut the broccoli, you know, for a day's worth of service here. So there's a tremendous amount of time and energy into doing what we do. We spend a lot of time really working with our staff, cooking with our staff, teaching our staff, standing next to them all day long, helping them do what we do and learn more skills. One of the things that happens when you're changing children's food is sometimes they don't like it. Shortly after I came, I got rid of two things. One of the things I got rid of was the nachos. And at this school, the kids revolted. And the nachos were regular trans fat laden chips with that orange DayGlow stuff that comes out of a can that doesn't have any cheese. And these kids, like for a long time, wouldn't eat because of that. And we had some problems with the pizza as well. And what I did was we went and worked with the kids. With the pizza problem, I went to the school that really was having that problem, Malcolm X, and we talked about pizza, we talked about how they would like it, we talked about, you know, why they couldn't have exactly what they had before. And with the nacho project, we actually, myself and another chef, really researched and made what we think of as a kind of healthy nacho. And we came up with a good flaxseed chip, and there's no cheese sauce. It has beans or rice or chicken, and it has grated cheese. And we make it sort of like a dipping thing, so it's a little different. It's touching the kids over and over and over. And, you know, after a while, it starts to make a difference. These are some of my kids with a salad bar. I put salad bars in all of our schools when I got there. Everyone says it couldn't be done. Little kids couldn't eat off the salad bar. Big kids would spit in it. Neither happened. To Berkeley, all of the food came in these plastic bags. Grilled cheese sandwiches, extremo burritos, pizza pockets. This food was never touched by human hands. And now we have salad bars in every school every day. We have no trans fats, no high fructose corn syrup. Fresh fruits and vegetables every meal, and all of our food is cooked from scratch. We feed children real food.
Eating is a very special thing we all must do. Eating keeps us growing, and it keeps you growing too. Eating makes us strong and tall, or fast and small and furry. Eating makes us friendlier, so we get soft and furry. Eating is important in a very special way. You must eat very carefully, so you'll get bigger every day.
I like to eat, eat, eat apples and bananas. I like to eat, eat, apples and bananas. A lake to eat, 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 apples and bananas. Bananas? A